Hi, everyone. Welcome and thank you for joining us for our July episode of Chain Reaction. My name is Taylor Young, and I am the Assistant Director of the National Keratoconus Foundation. We are a patient advocacy program based in Southern California at the University of California, Irvine. NKCF provides information to patients and families and raises public awareness of this cornea disease. We invite you to visit our website, nkcf.org, and sign up for our newsletter and to register for our bi-monthly webinars. We also post news on our LinkedIn, Instagram, and Facebook pages. This is episode 16 of Chain Reaction, our Ask the Expert podcast. Our partner is Dr. Clark Chang, a noted keratoconus expert and friend of NKCF. You can view past episodes by going to nkcf.org/webinars. Dr. Chang is currently the Director of Specialty Contact Lenses on the Cornea Service at Wills Eye Hospital in Philadelphia. He is also a member of the Medical Affairs team at Glaukos, the company that makes the FDA-approved cross-linking product and equipment. He is a graduate of the Pennsylvania College of Optometry and a fellow of the American Academy of Optometry. Dr. Chang was also named the NKCF Top Doc in 2020. We also have a special guest with us today, Dr. Eddie Bitton, and I'll let Dr. Chang go ahead and introduce her.
Thank you, Taylor. So we have one of my very good friends and someone I look up to for a very long time now and still does, Dr. Eddie Bitton. Yes, I'm trying very difficult to put on my French accent for everybody. And you'll see why in a moment because where Dr. Bitton is coming from. But please do not ask me to read her bio or to give you her bio in French because I'm incapable of doing that. But let me just tell you a little bit about her impressive career up to this moment, which I'm sure she's going to teach us a lot and she's going to go on and there will be a lot more that I could add to her bio next time we talk to her. She completed her optometry degree at University of Waterloo in Canada, followed by a master's in physiological optics from the University of Montreal in the area of tear film and tear film clinical physiology and its relevance in patients exhibiting dry eye. And Dr. Bitton presently holds the rank of a full professor, as well as being the director of the dry eye clinic at the school, which is a first in an optometry school in North America. And in 2015, Dr. Bitton was invited by the Tear Film Ocular Society, or so-called, or is also known as TFOS, T-F-O-S, to participate in the TFOS Juice 2 workshop, which is a global initiative to redefine dry eye, and has recently also been invited to join the next initiative entitled A Lifestyle Epidemic Ocular Surface Diseases. So we're looking forward to, obviously, as you can hear, to learn a lot from her during this July Dry Awareness Month. So Dr. Bitton, thank you for being here with us today. How are you today?
Thank you. I'm very well. Thank you so much for the invitation. I'm really pleased to be here. And July is Dry Eye Month. So happy Dry Eye Month, and let's bring further awareness about dry eye in this podcast. So I'm very psyched about it.
Me too. Let's see if we can make our dry eye and keratoconus patients very happy. So off the bat, we have quite a few questions lined up for you, and some questions from this is truly an international podcast now because we have questions even submitted from one of our listeners from Europe. So we'll get to those questions. And obviously, with the vast awareness and vast importance of dry eye impacting just about any patients nowadays, can you tell us a little bit about what are the different type of dry eyes and how do they affect patients in general?
Well, that's a very easy question, but a very complicated answer, but I'll do the best I can. Dry eyes used to be, known as something that happened to older people. You know, younger people never usually complained of dry eye, but our work and play environment is a lot different today with a lot of digital device use and other things that we do for hobbies. So we are dependent on our eyes. Now, dry eyes is quite complicated, but let's first start with the basics. You have here a photo of the tear film. The tear film actually has about three layers, but they're not distinct. One mixes into the other. So the one that is further out or the most external, open to the environment, is a very thin oily layer, and that protects the rest of the tear film that is mainly water-based. And then right next to the surface of the eye, we have a particular layer that is mucus-based. So it allows the cornea to be wetted by the tears. So when we talk about dry eyes, we could talk about any problem on any one of these layers or combination of layers. Now, you could imagine it if the oil layer, the oily layer that is external, is not there, then the rest of the tear film evaporates very quickly. So when we look at what kind of dry eyes are available in when we examine patients, most of them have a problem with the oily layer. And so I'm going to show you where the oily layer comes from. They actually come from the glands in our lids. And I think that I have a photo here, so we'll advance that. There you go. And so we have glands in the upper and lower lids, and you could see them here. They are nice and linear, very long, and they are all nice and straight. And we didn't really pay much attention to them, but now we do when we look at them clinically, because now we have instruments that could visualize through the lids. And so we have these instruments now called mibographers that can use infrared imaging, and we can image these glands. And this has really opened up the whole diagnosis of dry eye. And you'll see in the next slide that we have, there you go, we have the top image here that shows us the glands are nice and linear and long and next to each other. And when we blink, they will give us this nice oily tear film that comes out from the openings of these glands, which are right at the lid margin. Exactly. But as we move down these images, you could see that some of them are lost, some of them are at 50% capacity, some of them are completely disoriented. And so this is when we start getting what is called meibomian gland dysfunction, or MGD for short. And many people have that. Most dry eye is actually this kind of evaporative problem because the oily layer doesn't work very well. So the image to the right, when someone ends up actually blinking, instead of having this nice natural liquid oil, you get this very thickened oil and it just doesn't do a good job. So the tear film evaporates quickly and people tend to blink a lot more to try to replenish that lubricating effect. And people also use artificial tears. People also try to, it just evaporates. So there's symptoms of burning and itching and irritation and gritty feeling. So as you could see, it's actually much more complicated. But most people who have dry eyes have a problem with these glands.
Yeah, that's great. And I'm marveling at these images that you're showing us from your clinic and thinking, or the ones that you use as demonstrations to show your patients, and thinking, what did we used to do? There are patients who, this explains, obviously, number one, they're clinically, you and I have both seen patients who claim that they have been treated with, dry eyes, or some of them even been, have the symptoms that you talked about, sandy sandiness and grittiness, and they've never really been properly diagnosed because potentially the layer in their tears are fine, but it's the glands that are atrophied or partially atrophied. So these, you know, obviously these meibomian gland myography is really helping you in diagnosing these patients or catching these patients. So what would you say to patients who may be coming to you and you know that they're giving you all the dry symptoms, but they feel like they either have failed prior treatment or maybe they have never been diagnosed? How do you convince them to continue to explore the possibility of future dry treatment or even getting a proper diagnosis from your eye exam?
Well, as you mentioned, I was part of the TFOS DOES 2 initiative. And again, that's a Tear Film Ocular Society dry eye workshop. The whole purpose of TFOS DOES 2 was to have this global initiative to look at everything that has ever been published on dry eye and to try to see what are the gaps in dry eye presently and to redefine dry eye. And the definition of dry eye now is very different than it was 30 years ago. So a lot of people may have been told during an eye exam, oh, you just have dry eye, use this artificial tear, you should be fine, I'll see you next year. This is no longer what is happening, or at least what should happen. When we see a few symptoms and we try to dive in a little bit more, I'm only showing you one instrument, the meibographer, but there are many more tests and many more advances in the dry eye space. So now we actually could really do an in-depth evaluation of your tear film, and as well as look for signs of inflammation, because now we know that dry eye is an inflammatory disease. And so there are many questions we want to ask, many questions about your general health, many questions about that contribute to dry eye, such as your age, such as whether you have, are you postmenopausal or not? Are you, what is your sex in terms of women are much more at risk, especially postmenopausal for dry eye. Like I said, dry eye is actually quite complicated. So we have to play the detective to try to figure out what is causing your dry eye. And so the therapy is not a single thing. It usually is a few things. And patients get frustrated because they think that there's so many things they have to do, but we are so further along than we were before. We actually have much more to offer our patients, which is extremely encouraging.
Absolutely, yeah. And thank you for doing, and thank you and to your fellow TFOS members for doing the work and continuing to guide us clinically in how to managing these patients. And there's one point that you had hit on that I feel like patients, I don't know if they have heard it, so I want to say it again. I completely agree with you that we have traditionally really underestimated the complexity, the biocomplexity of the tear film, right? We tend to say, oh, it's just dry eye, really minimizing that diagnosis and making patients think that, well, then all that I need are some over-the-counter treatments. And if that doesn't work, then maybe I just don't have dry eye, or maybe there's nothing more that can be done for me. And we are showing like the very first image that we show patients with multiple layers, with the three different layers of the, you know, the oil or the lipid layer, the aqueous layer with the water component, and the mucin layer to kind of help the spread of the water component of the tear film. I mean, the interaction of the electrolytes and the lipid and the protein and how they interact with each other really goes beyond the description of that layer model. And so it's a lot more complicated than we could even, you know, than I can explain to my patients biochemically what is happening. And so it also explains in my mind why, like you said, a single treatment may not always hit the target, because you need to be treating upstream to what the, you know, multiple sources of deficiency that is causing that may be causing these symptoms for our dry eye patients. And so that then comes to, you know, that comes to something that's even of a particular interest for our keratoconus patient members and their family. And that is, can you tell us what are some of the ways that dry eyes given how, you know, as prevalent as it is nowadays, that we realize with all these new instrumentation detection that you've mentioned, how can dry eyes impact our keratoconus patients?
Well, that's an excellent question. So the first thing, as we look at this slide again, and it really is, as you mentioned, extremely simplified, because in this particular three-layered tear film, it is hugely complex, and it is actually what feeds and lubricates the front of the eye, the cornea. The cornea does not have blood vessels. It cannot, because we want to be able to see clearly. So it has to maintain a clarity. And in keratoconus, we know that it's the cornea that is affected and that it is a progressive disease. There's been some really interesting literature, some out of Spain and some out of Israel, some out of different parts of the world, that show us that actually keratoconic patients have more dry eye than the non-keratoconic patients. And so that part is interesting in itself, because I think that keratoconic patients, having gone through the diagnosis of keratoconus, are so worried about their cornea and about their vision, that, as we mentioned, dry eye kind of takes a side step. But addressing dry eye could actually help certain things. So, for example, I'd like to get to the slide where we talk about blepharitis. Mm-hmm. Between meibomian gland disease and between blepharitis, which I'm going to explain in a second, this is the slide. These two things actually are the main reasons that people go to a doctor for consultation, to an eye doctor. It's basically the symptoms that are associated with meibomian gland disease, which is dry eye, or blepharitis. Now, what is blepharitis? Blepharitis comes from the Latin term blef, which it means lid, and itis means inflammation. So we have an inflammation of the eyelid. As you could see in this photo on the left side, it is a bit red, and you could see a bit of debris all along the types of eyelashes. Some debris could be at the root of the eyelash, some debris could be at the middle or at the base, different parts. And we could see on the right side, obviously, a healthy lid margin. But blepharitis itself actually comes from many different causes. We can have an overgrowth of bacteria. We can have an overgrowth of fungus. We can have even some parasites be part of the problem that causes us to have blepharitis. Now, I mentioned that the tear film has to be in extreme balance between those three layers. So imagine this debris, or whatever is causing the debris, such as the overgrowth of bacteria or other things, falling into the ocular surface every time you blink. Well, obviously, that's going to change the balance of the tear film and hence the actual symptoms. So blepharitis often causes us to feel symptoms of grittiness, irritation, and we start rubbing our eyes. Well, here's where it gets interesting for your keratoconic patients. Because we know, although we don't know everything about what causes keratoconus, we know that eye rubbing is actually part of a problem that increases the progression of keratoconus. So anything that we can do to tailor or to sort of reduce the eye rubbing behavior would be an advantage to a keratoconic patient, because we really want to protect the cornea. The cornea is already in a frail state, and so we want to be able to curtail that behavior of eye rubbing. So what happens when we have blepharitis? Well, usually we're given something to do and take home, so some sort of lid hygiene therapy, or sometimes we even have therapies that we could do in the office. But you first have to be properly diagnosed at what type of blepharitis you have, so that the eye care practitioner could basically give you the right at-home or in-office lid therapy, because the ingredients in those lid hygiene therapies are not the same and they don't target. So here we've got keratoconic patients that we want to try to not rub their eyes. And we also have studies that say that keratoconic patients have more dry eyes, more blepharitis than normals. So it kind of goes to say that yes, keratoconus is important for you to continue looking into, but at the same time, go back to your eye care practitioner, especially if you continue to have this grittiness or itchy type of behavior, to try to say, hey, do I also have dry eyes? Because the management could really help if you could curtail that behavior.
Yeah, I mean, complete agreement. And that part that the you mentioned, one particular publication from Israel from 2018, if I remember correctly, which I think mentioned indicated or at least proposed a very interesting mechanism relating to the eye rubbing that you were talking about, where blepharitis can be caused by bacterial flora or pathogen, and then potentially, you know, rubbing transmitting more pathogen in different area over the annexa or the, you know, surrounding area of your eye, and then potentially leading to more inflammation that then possibly can sort of help along with further keratoconus progression. So I find that article to be interesting, at least, you know, in the way that it's proposing the potential associated mechanism of, you know, what we want to do if we want to watch our patients to control their progression more than just, you know, the treatments that we have, such as, you know, cross-linking and other contact lenses and such. So yeah, I agree with you. Now, you also mentioned a very interesting point about lid hygiene and home treatment and office treatment. And the reason I think that's very interesting, obviously, I know you have a lot of treatment options in your dry clinic for your patients coming in to see you. I'd like to ask you for an opinion. When one of the conventional treatments that we often ask patients to do when they have the deficiency with the meibomian glands, which are the vertical glands that you show in an earlier picture within their eyelid, we ask them to do a warm compress to use thermal energy to break down the obstructions within the glands to see if that would help with the expression and the free flowing of the oil. But a lot of times we also ask them to combine it with a little bit of lid massaging to kind of break down mechanically the lipid material within the eyelid. I tend to ask my keratoconus patients not to do that. Do just the first part of the thermal warm compress, but don't rub their eyes. Do you agree with that? How else do you manage your patients, keratoconus patients, with MGD or meibomian gland dysfunction related dry eyes?
Well, it's been pretty clear in the literature that eye rubbing is to be avoided in keratoconus. So we try not to give them that recommendation. However, when you do warm compresses, the purpose of the warm compress is to really warm up that lipid that is now very thick. I tell patients this because it's a really good image for them to have. We have all put salad dressing that is olive oil based in the fridge. You know, you didn't finish your salad dressing, you put it in the fridge, and the next day you take it out because you want to use it again. And you notice that it is no longer liquid. It is all this white, very thickened oil. And the only way that we could get it back to liquid is to leave it outside and rewarm it. And that's exactly what you're doing with warm compresses. We are trying to rewarm and to liquefy basically that lipid that has become very solid. However, once it's liquefied, we want it to get out of the eyelid. And so if you cannot rub or massage, what you can do is do a couple of blinks, you know, hard blinks, so that it could try to get them out. But that has not been shown in the literature that is either useful or not, but that could be an alternative to eye rubbing or eye massaging specifically in your keratoconic patients. So that's what I would tell for now, but certainly that would be a good option for a study sometime in the future.
Right, and looking forward to that if you take on that study. And And I laugh when you were, I smile when you were describing that analogy, because you know, Dr. Bitton really knows the way to my heart, which is through food. So you and I both have like a lot of food analogies to explain to our patients. So I use chicken soup and the fat layer in the fridge.
Yeah.
As the example of the parallel to your salad dressing.
There you go.
So in any case, so yeah, I agree that definitely avoid eye rubbing, and obviously that sets up a possibility, like you said, minimizing mechanical potential microtrauma to the surface of the eye, even if it's through eyelid, or maybe those are the patients that could potentially benefit more from an in-office treatment where the surface of their cornea can be more protected throughout the treatment duration.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And again, I mean, you mentioned something. We don't want to get rid of all the bacteria. There's a certain amount of bacteria that we need on the eye. It actually helps us. So we don't want to get rid of all of it. We do want to be able to make sure that there's not an overgrowth of bacteria or other things that should not be on the surface, such as fungus should not be on the ocular surface, such as parasites should not be on the ocular surface. So those are the kind of things that we want to really make sure that we maybe not eliminate completely, but that we really reduce. So the word blepharitis is just an overall term, but your eye care practitioner will be able to look at the debris, be able to really identify its type, so that they could give you the lid hygiene that is most appropriate for that type of blepharitis. But, and that's been a challenge because, you know, we kind of put blepharitis under the same umbrella, and we shouldn't. We now need to really be able to home in. Now, I'd like to make just a small recommendation. A lot of people have had eyelid hygiene suggested to them by using baby shampoo. Or diluted baby shampoo. Unfortunately, that is no longer really the mainstay because studies have shown that that actually destroys the tear film itself. So if you do use baby shampoo, I think it's time to upgrade to some of the newer lid hygiene products that are much more tailored to the type of blepharitis that you have.
Yes, no, I agree. Go for the Ferrari treatment in dry therapy, everyone. Listen to Dr. Bitton. Now, we also know the importance of keeping good lid hygiene because that can also impact the health of their contact lens wear. And we know a lot of keratoconus patients heavily rely on their contact lenses as their primary modality for their vision. So how can something like dry eye affect their, say, scleral lenses? Because a lot of questions have been written in or submitted in the past about the scleral lenses. So could you talk to us a little bit about how dry eyes affect scleral lenses?
That's an excellent, well, I'll start with how dry eyes could affect contact lens wear, period. Because contact lenses, just imagine a piece of plastic being put on your eye, but you don't have that buffer, that cushion of a good tear film to be able to support it. So comfortable contact lens wear usually requires tear film, or at least good tear film. So if you could address the dry eye problem or the imbalance first, that would really help you. Now, there's been actually a great study that just came out more recently about the use of contact lenses. It's a study out of the US. It came out in 2021 and looked at the contact lenses worn by keratoconic patients. And like you mentioned, most of them do wear more harder type of contact lenses. So what we call rigid gas permeable. And now some of the bigger lenses called scleral lenses. And they took a look at, you know, what are the advantages of the scleral lenses over the other type of lenses. Well, the number one thing that they did show was that keratoconic patients, most of them suffer from dry eyes. And that was something that was really important to note, because I think that that is underscored when they go in for their keratoconus problems, that the practitioner may not address the dry eye as much. And that is important to do so. So most keratoconic patients have dry eyes already. So that's something that we could at least help them. And if you do have some dry eye, the tear film is imbalanced, if we can try to rebalance it as much as possible, not only will that improve your vision, but that'll improve your comfort at wearing those lenses. So in that study, they did take a look at the scleral lenses, and they did notice that there was an advantage to wearing scleral contact lenses, mainly for grittiness. So people had less gritty type symptoms at wearing scleral lenses if they were keratoconic. And also the other thing is that they performed better with, windy conditions or poor humidity or environmental conditions. And so that's something to note. So I think that out of all the options, scleral lenses have obviously have become more popular in the last decade, and more designs are available for keratoconus. And so I think that those are all really great options for keratoconic patients. So we really have a lot more to offer keratoconic patients than we ever have. And that makes it very, very not only exciting, but comforting for patients to know that they may have options.
Yeah, no, I agree. And I do still want to go back to, I want to highlight one point that you had made a little while ago during our discussion about typically a combination treatment is needed. We talked about the complexity of the tiers. And again, if everybody kind of recall in their mind that sort of simplified layer model, it is extremely satisfying, of course, to see that, Arthur Shorter et al. From that 2021 publication that you mentioned, where they supported the what you and I thought to be true, which is having a scleral lens on the eye, provided that the solution underneath the lens is as according to your eye doctor's or your eye care professional's recommendation, then it creates an isolated cover to protect the surface of your eye and your tear film underneath the lens. Away from that external environment, which sometimes can be toxic to certain chemistry on the tear surface for some patients. And so we know that to be true. The reason I brought up that layer model again, I want everybody to imagine when you put a lens, a plastic material like Dr. Bitonia just say on the eye, it separates those layers, right? So you now have a thinner tear film layer in front of your contact lens and the rest of your tear film underneath that contact lens along with the solution that you put in. Why does that matter? It matters because some of my dry keratoconus patients still comes to me and say, it's maybe better with the scleral lens, but my eyes are still dry. And they're not thinking about the fact that their own tear has not been boosted to be healthy enough to support a healthy, thinner layer on top of their contact lens. So while their cornea may not dry out, the surface of the lens could still dry out until they get to a certain stage. And that's where I typically, and I want to ask Dr. Baton's opinion, that's where I typically would obviously give them combination therapy. Maybe I'll give them a therapeutics or immunomodulator at the same time to use when they're not wearing contact lenses morning and night. What's your suggestions there with patients who may feel frustrated that they thought scleral lens was going to work immediately?
Well, I'd love to have a magic solution, but unfortunately we don't have a magic solution, neither for keratoconus or for dry eyes. And like I said, they usually present in combination. And so you definitely want to try to enhance that tear film as much as possible. When you put on a contact lens, it doesn't necessarily split the tear film into two. We actually don't know how much is in front of it and how much is in back of it. We now have tools that we could measure the amount of tear film, but not how much oil, water, mucus is in front versus the back. And so that is really, you're disrupting the tear film when you put on a contact lens. But that being said, it is important for vision. So we do have other options. I don't think that there's a single dry eye patient that I follow that I only give them one thing. It's a combination of things. And the beauty now is that you have artificial tears. The industry has really started to understand some of the sort of gaps that we had in dry eye. So there are some artificial tears that are actually oil based, and then other artificial tears are mainly water based. So coming back to making a diagnosis, the proper type of diagnosis for dry eye is quite important for anybody. So we need to understand symptoms with a validated questionnaire. We also need to take a look at your tear film to try to understand what type of dry eye you may have. Do you have more the oily based problem, which is most of the population? And do you have more of not enough dry eye? not enough tear film, excuse me. So you could have very little volume, or you could have a lot of volume but poor quality. So everybody is very different, but the options that are there now are amazing, and we continue to develop in this field. There's a, as we mentioned, that dry eye is inflammatory. We now have more and more options that are therapeutic, so it's prescription drugs that really bring down the inflammation. So they're anti-inflammatory. Some of them are what we call immunomodulators, but they are anti-inflammatory. That's their role. So as much as we can do to bring down the inflammation, it will help the tear film, and that will eventually also enhance your contact lens wear and your vision that comes with it. We know that people with dry eyes, and if some of you have been on vacation to a very windy area, for example, like the beach, you know, you're at the ocean, you're at the lakefront, you get this wind. When you try to read at the beach, after a little bit with the wind, if you're not wearing some sort of protective sunglasses, your tear film dries out and you can't read your book or your magazine or whatever, your Kindle or whatever it is you're using. It's really more difficult. So instinctively, what do? We try to blink more so that we could replenish our tear film, but that doesn't always work because it's evaporating really quickly. So anything that you could protect by sunglasses, artificial tears, will stabilize your vision. And so that's what I'm saying with keratoconic patients. Obviously, you're wearing these scleral lenses, they're fantastic, but sometimes you need some artificial tears on top of that, and not, you know, you want to be able to discuss which artificial tears, because again, they are not created equal. So when you go to the pharmacy, don't pick them on your own. Ask your eye care practitioner what is their best recommendation.
Right. And you and I can understand how confusing that is for patients, because there's a big aisle of all these bottle products or and preservative free single use products, which I prefer, and I'm sure you do too. And patients think they're all the same. And sometimes within the same brand, there's so many different ones. They have no idea what the differences are. So talking about in the remaining moments that we have, a specific question that came in from one of our listener in Europe is that my son has keratoconus and is using this artificial tear called Hycosyn Plus. And how many times a day, asking for our opinion, how many times they should her son put a drop in the eyes, and or should there be other eye drops that they should consider, which you had already mentioned the idea of needing to hit the correct target mechanism within an artificial tear. What advice do you have for this listener?
So I could tell the listener is not from North America, because we don't have Hycosyn Plus here. In Canada, where I practice, we do have one of their drops that is a subsidiary of that company, but nevertheless, this is a preservative-free drop that is very gelatinous, very viscous, very comfortable. And so the first thing I would tell your listener that sent in this question was that because it is preservative-free, they could use it as needed. So if they need 4 times a day, 6 times a day, 8 times a day, go ahead. I don't know the particulars of the case, so obviously it's hard to, you know, really give some tailored answer. And then they should really go back to talk to their eye care practitioner to say, is it safe for them to use it 10 times? Of course, it depends what is the sun doing. If they're on video games, then obviously they're going to need to use it even more. That being said, we did mention that artificial tears are very different now. They're more complex. The research and the chemistry that goes into the new generation artificial tears is really brilliant. It's really quite interesting. However, that means that for us, the doctors, we have to now understand a little bit more of that chemistry to be able to tailor which artificial tear we recommend. For the patient, like you mentioned, in front of a pharmacy, it's extremely confusing. If we, as eye care practitioners, really look at the tear film and be able to understand what kind of dry eye they have, then we can tailor the artificial tear recommendation. And if the person is not comfortable with that one, we can make other recommendations. But to switch from one to the other because it's on sale, or because I ran out, or oh, I'm at the airport and I'm just taking that one is not a good idea. They may not be compatible with your contact lenses. They may actually cause clumps of debris on your contact lenses. So you really want to, a lot of the artificial tears on the market are great. A lot of the contact lenses are great, but sometimes putting them together is not always great. So again, speak to your eye care practitioner if you're having a problem with the artificial tear that they recommended, to ask them for another choice, because you may not want something that is not tailored to you. You think you might be saving money, but in fact, you're probably wasting your money if you're not using the right type of artificial tear. And dry eye is complicated, but it is hopeful because there are many options for you. Keratoconus is complicated, but again, it is hopeful because there are many options. So I hope that some of this discussion will make you a bit hopeful, but especially to the listeners that have keratoconus.
Oh, I mean, it certainly has helped me obtain my optimism. So yes, I'm hoping that it would do the same for our listeners as well. And so everybody, as you could hear from the compassions of within Dr. Bitton's discussion, you know that we're in a treat whenever we see her pop on the screen. And so I at the very least wanted to say Dry Awareness Month is July. And I know that Dr. Bitton has a few more activities that she's planning on social media and videos, so please watch out for those. And Dr. Bitton, do you have any last words that you would like to impart on our audience before I throw the mic back to Taylor?
So I just want to tell your audience, thank you so much for inviting me, but I do want to tell them about the next TFOS initiative called Lifestyle and Epidemic. And that is, anything that we do to and around our eyes could affect our tear film and the ocular surface. So just think about some of the things that you do, such as sunscreen, cosmetics, lid hygiene, any surgery, digital use of that could affect your blinking. All that will be discussed in the next initiative, which we are working on this year. So there's more information to come. But again, thank you so much for allowing me to share my passion about dry eye. And I hope that was useful to your keratoconic patients.
I am sure it is. I have learned a lot. Taylor, I'll throw the mic back to you.
Well, thank you both for guiding us through these questions and for raising awareness about dry eye and keratoconus. I think it's great. And everyone, next month, you can watch another Chang Reaction episode. You can also go back online onto our website, nkcf.org, and check out our past episodes as well. And so if anyone listening has a keratoconus related question, you can submit them on our website at the link on the screen. And finally, NKCF operates with the support of friends and donors. If you feel the urge to support us, you can make a much appreciated online donation to the UCI Foundation. And in closing, I just again want to thank Dr. Chang and Dr. Bitton for taking the time to work with us and answer our listener questions. And I hope everyone has a fun and safe 4th of July and a happy dry eye month.
And may I just say, today's Canada Day too, so July 1st. I also want to wish all Canadians and Dr. Bitton happy Canada Day.
Thank you.